upon entrance, he writes, he is subjected to a series of abasements, degradations, humiliations, profanations of the self. The self is systematically mortified. Self-mortification, role dispossession, curtailment of the self, obedience tests, will-breaking contests, physical indignities, forced confessions, all of these serve to create anxiety, loss of autonomy, and loss of a sense of safety. Those of you who are in cults, you know the drill. I don't really have to explain this to you. You've been there. But such an assault upon the self is the crux of behavior modification, of thought reform. And I cite these various researchers and professionals not to bore you with academic references, but to help you understand that for decades there have been social scientists who have studied this phenomenon, who have criticized it, have pointed out the dangers and devastating effects. There is actually a long history of institutional abuse in its many forms, and on some level you too are now experts in this field. But people want to deny that this exists or deny that this happens, and I think that's why it's important to go back to this history and show that no, this is not new, this is not made up, this is not pseudoscience. People have been studying and reporting on this for decades. So the desired effect from the organization's point of view is a new self whose actions are dictated by the will or purpose of the actor or leader he has identified with. This is why people obey even when they're not around the group. It is then that will, the internalized will of the other, of the system, that generates one's own internal sanctions for future actions. Bounded choice is constrained then by both external and internal sanctions, real or imagined. And I want to just put in a bit here about free will, because this came up earlier. This issue of free will versus informed consent. I do not agree, it's one of the things I disagreed with Margaret Singer about. I do not agree that there is a loss of free will, and that people aren't acting under free will when they do things in cults. The only way we're not acting out of true free will is if someone's holding a gun to our head, right? You can always do something else, so to speak, right? Theoretically. But in these situations, and this is what's important to understand, and this is what's important for us to get the courts to understand when we take cases to court. Free will, first of all, is a very amorphous term, but a person's free will is subsumed under the will of the group or the leader, and one's free will is altered or distorted, right? So yes, we're making choices. This is my whole thing about bounded choice. Yes, we're making choices, but we know exactly what choice we have to make if we want to stay in the good graces of the group, right? And if we don't make that choice, well, we know, you know, hell is out there, our parents are gonna die, whatever they threatened us with, right? So it's a matter of life and death in many cases, and in some cases it's a real matter of life and death. So this issue of free will being altered and distorted is really important to get across, because yes, no one held a gun to my head, I did the things I did, because I didn't want to face, at that point, I didn't think I could face the outside world. I didn't think I could go through that door. So choices are constrained by the closed-mindedness of the system and the closed-mindedness of the individual who functions in alliance with that system. So now for the burning question, how do I undo it?
I'm going to skip a bunch of slides where I like this one. So here's what we have. The leader has all the truth. You're now an elite with special knowledge. You must deny yourself to be fully part of the group. Members are to blame for whatever goes wrong. The leader is responsible for whatever goes right, and everything else is evil. That's my 6 points in a nutshell. and here's my better graphic of my vision. So, how do we undo it? So let me say first, for those of you who may be in pain, who may think the mental confusion and personal anguish will never end, I know it sounds trite, but it's true that time heals all wounds. So let time be your ally. And please take comfort in knowing that hundreds of thousands, if not millions, have gone this road before, and there is light at the end of the tunnel. But you can cut down the time, and you can shorten the tunnel,
For one, by doing what you're doing this weekend, coming together with others who've experienced the same kind of trauma as you have, and engaging in what Margaret Singer and now I call psychoeducation. But as to this question, how do I undo it? Well, I don't believe that there's only one answer to that question. In fact, I no longer think there's one answer to hardly any question, except perhaps, what does 1 + 1 equal? One of the paradoxical consequences of living outside a cult or a closed system like you were in is that life gets more complex and a person is no longer satisfied with simplistic solutions, simplistic answers. There are two fundamental axioms to remember in dealing with some of the after effects. One, we are socialized to respond to and respect authority figures. And two, we are social animals who respond almost without thinking to peer pressure. Keeping that in mind may help ease some of the guilt and shame. When I work one-on-one with former cult members, there are several things I ask them to do that usually helps, and that involves deconstructing the system that he or she was in to gain a full understanding of what was at play. And of course, to recognize that because of what Lifton called milieu control, control of information, of social contact, of outside realities, while you were in the cult, you were playing with less than a full deck. So in addition to the controlled environment, along with the physical and or psychological abuse, you were subjected to constant berating, badgering, exhaustion, malnutrition, various deprivations, all the while living in a depraved setting. So if any of you bought into it, if you succumbed in any way, don't beat yourself up. What else could you have done? Give yourself a break. It's time to take the pressure off. The keys to recovery are balance and moderation, both of which were quite likely absent in the cult. So this is just these are some of the points that I wrote about in Cults in Our Midst, the book that I did with Margaret Singer, of why it's so difficult to leave. I'm not going to go through each one of those, but when you think about it, and again, if you were born in the group, much of this becomes even more difficult because you don't have a past to run back to. You don't necessarily have family to run back to. You don't have old friends to look up. Things that we who joined as adults did have. So all of these things help keep one enmeshed in the group. Some may have been more important than others to people, and some of them may not apply at all. But generally, people always ask, why didn't you leave? And I get that question all the time. You know, or when they interviewed me on TV about Elizabeth, when Elizabeth Smart was kidnapped, you know, well, why didn't she just run away? I'm like, give me a break. She's a 14-year-old girl who was raised in an utterly, sheltered environment. You know, they tied her to a tree and raped her and told her they were going to kill her parents. She's going to get up and run away? You know, come on. So we have to remember there's lots of reasons why it's difficult to leave. So at the beginning of this presentation, I mentioned some of the typical after effects: anxiety, indecision, worry, fear, either too little or too much sleep, confusion, guilt, loneliness, flashbacks, shame, obsessive thoughts, depression, suicidal thoughts, identity crises, loss of memory, panic attacks, anger, and so on. If you're experiencing any of these, or all of these, that's normal. I mean, I can remember I was 41 years old. I went to New York to work because I wanted to get away from San Francisco where my cult was, so I went as far as I could without dropping in the ocean. You know, and I got there, I certainly had had bank accounts before, but I really couldn't remember how to own a bank account. I really couldn't, I think you said yesterday, I didn't know how to put one foot in front of the other. I was so terrified, and I was so tired. All I wanted to do was sleep. You know, and so there's like so much, and I couldn't read. You know, here I was. I graduated with honors from the University of Wisconsin. I had been a Fulbright scholar. I couldn't read the newspaper. I couldn't read even the front page of the newspaper without my eyes going screwy. I mean, I was fried. 10.5 years of 7 days a week, 5 a.m. to 1 a.m, working our butts off, criticizing people, tearing people apart, expelling people, discipline and control boards, la, 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 la. I was a mess.
But I was also ecstatic. You know, I was like, it was like being let out of prison. It's like, wow, you know? And then here I was in New York. Oh my God. I hadn't seen a movie in 10 years. I didn't know from nothing. And I'm in the cultural mecca, right? And, you know, I'd have to go out on these business lunches and people would say, well, what do you like to do on your time off? And I remember one time I said, go shopping. What a terribly mundane thing to say. You know, these are like fancy people. I'm saying, you know, I should have said go to the museum, but I hadn't yet been to a museum. You know? I remember watching the Oscars. The Oscars used to be in January, earlier than they are now. And I remember, and I got out of my cult at the end of November. I moved to New York in January. So whenever the Oscars come on, I'm sitting in a little apartment in Pelham, New York, a suburb of Manhattan. And I'm watching the Oscars for the first time in, you know, from Pelham. And I just sat there and cried and cried and cried. I didn't know any of the movies they were talking about. It was the year Amadeus won. I remember that distinctly. I hadn't seen any of the movies. It didn't matter. There I was, sitting in my living room. Nobody was bugging me. Nobody was calling me to go do something. And I could just watch normal TV. And that was so cool. I mean, and then I'd watch Sunday football. I mean, football. I would make myself a big bowl of popcorn, and I'd get out a beer, and I would sit and watch those football games, and I was happy as a clam. You know, it's like, wow, this is so cool. I get to actually do leisure things. The other side of it, eventually, I cracked and had to go to therapy, but and I'll explain how that happened. You know, because a lot of times I think when people come out of cults, they have no conception of how they come across to people, how they self-present, right? I remember working with a girl who had been in the garbage years, and they had biblical names and they spoke biblical language. She had a job at the Hallmark store, and she, you know, she spoke like thou and the, you know, whatever, house and duff and, you know, and so she worked at a Hallmark store in some suburb of San Francisco, and she came to see me one day. She said, you know, I like my job and everything, but all the customers look at me so funny all the time. And I said to her, I said, do you know how you sound when you talk? Like, do you understand that you don't speak like I speak? Like, the words are different? And she had no clue. I mean, she had no clue that she was still speaking this sort of biblical kind of language. So what happened in my case, I was very lucky. I got a job with a man who had been one of our political contacts. And he ran a direct mail firm and a publishing house. Well, two things happened. He ran a publishing house of psychiatry and psychology books, Brenner Menzel. He's very famous. He was a fantastic man. And so he paid me very little though. So I worked for the direct mail part, but then at night I would proofread books for his publishing firm. So I'm sitting there one night with my big board and the big proofs of, I don't know if you know what page proofs look like from a publisher, they're big double pages. And I'm proofing this book. It's the very first book ever written on post-traumatic stress disorder in Vietnam vets by Charles Wheatley. First book that ever came out on that, right? And I'm proofreading this book. And all of a sudden, I'm like crying and crying and crying. And I'm like, I'm realizing that's me in those pages. Like, that's what I had gone through. And this is what I was suffering. It just blew my mind. But before that, I think it was before that, my boss would take me out to very fancy French dinners and stuff. I think because he felt guilty that he was paying me so little. And he would actually take me to one of those liquor outlets and buy me whatever booze I wanted, you know, bottles of fancy cognac. And I drank a lot then, actually. It was part of the therapy. I mean, I would just come home from work and drink and try to write, and oh, I was a mess. But anyway, so he would take me out to these fancy dinners. So it was time for my like 6-month review or something to go up to dinner. He had just a little company there, like 5 months for. We go out to dinner, and he said, you know, Janja, you've been working here 6 months now, and your work is fantastic, and you're doing a great job. But he said, there's something that really troubles me. He said, in the 6 months you've been here, I have never seen you smile, and I've never heard you laugh. And I was like, wow. I mean, that hit me so heavy. I had no clue. I mean, I consider myself a kind of fun person.
And I haven't really had a chance to do my act here, but I was just floored. I had no clue. I mean, I had no clue that that's what I was projecting. I was so distanced from myself because I had spent 10 and a half years denying myself, shutting myself down, and training myself to be emotionless. We could not cry. I mean, I was probably on trial more than anyone else. When we would put someone on trial, a chair in a room like this, 100 people there, and you could get criticized for 8 hours. People swearing at you, calling you names, dirty running dog, horrible. I mean, we spoke like sailors and whatever it was you said.
Truck drivers.
And no matter what they said, you had to take it and you could not shed a tear. If you started to cry, you had to leave the room until you composed yourself and then come back and got some more. So we were trained that way, right? Just like you couldn't cry, right? For your fault. So, you know, I was so out of touch with myself. So anyway, let me get back to this. So if you're experiencing any of these, it's normal. Since I went through it. So some of the other common effects are cognitive deficits, trouble concentrating, and an inability to think straight, things that may hinder you at school or work. Secondly, experiencing low self-esteem, self-doubt, and questioning yourself all the time. Three, feeling that you have regressed to a childlike state. Remember, you were in a situation that enforced a state of dependency and a loss of autonomy. When I got out of my group at age 41, I always say I felt like a stupid 15-year-old and a very tired 80-year-old at the same time. Four, sometimes feeling frozen with fear, unable to act or make a decision. People used to ask me, well, let's go to the movies. What do you want to see? Oh my God, I'm just like, oh, you decide. You decide. Oh, whatever you want to do is fine. I did that for years. Whatever you want to do is fine. I did not want to make a decision, and I did not want to take a stand. Right? Because for 10 years, I knew the stand to take. We had the stand. We had the only stand. So I didn't want to take stands anymore. I was ashamed that I had done that in the way that I had done that. So, it's very complex. And number five, wanting revenge, not knowing what to do with your anger. So let's start there with the anger. Anger is a normal reaction to the hurts and assaults you experienced. Anger is an appropriate response to abuse and exploitation. Some say that feeling angry is one of the first signs of recovery. Just as fear is the background of cultic control, anger can be the fuel of recovery. It fortifies your sense of what is right by condemning the wrong that was done to you. It gives you the energy and will to get through the ordeal of getting your life together. Suppression of anger while in the cult more than likely contributed to depression and a sense of helplessness. Now the reverse is possible. But bear in mind that anger can also be a double-edged sword, especially if turned inward toward the self or outward toward the wrong targets, innocent others. That type of reaction can lead to increased isolation. One outlet for many people has been poetry or writing to release the anger. Or writing letters that never get sent to your parents, to former leaders. Don't act on it willy-nilly. There's a big difference between thinking, feeling, and acting on it. I'm not a psychologist, so I can't diagnose you, but most people coming out of such situations do get diagnosed with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. That means the emotional roller coaster may go on for some time. You may step off and have smooth times for a while, and then the roller coaster comes by and sweeps you up again. That too is normal. The most important and effective thing you can do is find those aids that work for you. That process may or may not include professional therapy. The healing or recovery process varies for each of us, with ebbs and flows of progress, great insight, and profound confusion at times. I just want to mention, there was someone last night with us who had been in a cultic situation when he was younger, and he was saying 20 years later, he thought he was completely over it, and 20 years later something happened that triggered him. And he was so shocked that this had triggered him, but he said it took him 3 days to get over it. So these things are there. These are scars. These are emotional scars. And every now and then, it might resurface. Doesn't mean it has to control your life. It doesn't have to dominate you. But, and the more you recognize that it may be there, the more you can combat it. So I don't like to tout my own book, which is back there on the table and for sale for a brief, short $15. But Take Back Your Life was written specifically to help folks recover from similar traumatic experiences and has proven so helpful for so many people. My co-author and I were compelled to write the book because more often than not, people coming out of cults and extremist environments have difficulty finding practical information. I too experienced that obstacle back in 1986 when I got out. I seemed to encounter one roadblock after another when I searched for useful information or helping professionals who were knowledgeable about this type of trauma. And there are other good books out there as well. Another book I recommend is called The Language of Emotions. The Language of Emotions by Carla McLaren, M-C, capital L-A-R-E-N. Fantastic book, The Language of Emotions by Carla McLaren. She's brilliant. She's actually a former student of mine. She's someone who came back to school late. And she actually helped, she did the final edit on Take Back Your Life. And she's absolutely brilliant. She's now getting her master's degree and working with children. Dealing with your emotions may be one of the biggest areas of concern. Typically, as we grow up through life's various experiences, ups and downs, we learn the skills needed to handle and cope with a variety of situations. But you were likely removed from life just at the time when most folks are experiencing life, learning to sort through the challenges and acquire those skills. You were in an environment where your emotions and perceptions were manipulated and controlled. So now you have to face that developmental task, and it may at times seem just too daunting. You may not even be able to sort out one emotion from another, or what is an appropriate or inappropriate response. So again, get some useful aids. The books I mentioned, or a grounded therapist, or a trusted friend, and start to identify and distinguish between your various responses and reactions. How is anger different from fear, from frustration? How is sadness different from loneliness? How do you react when you're anxious? What sets it off? What can you do to avoid those situations or approach them differently? Keep a journal or a log. Start making sense of it. But most importantly, find a comfortable pace for your healing process. In the beginning, in particular, your mind and body may simply need a rest, and allow yourself that. If you're having triggers and flashbacks, there are little tricks and exercises in my book that can help you through that as well. A trigger can induce a dissociated state accompanied by a flood of memories. Sensory triggers are probably the most common. Sights, physical sensations, sounds, smells, tastes. These triggers are reminders of specific experiences or people and are unique to each person. When I first got on my cult, every time I traveled, every time I was in an airport, I thought I saw my cult leader. You know, I'd see some big, she was big, heavy set, you know, quite unbecoming. And I'd see some woman like that in the airport, oh my God, there she is! You know? So we have these triggers. They may bring back the ambiance of the place or engender specific emotional states or even physical sensations. You're not going crazy when these occur, although you may feel like it. The process of becoming immune to triggers begins when you become aware of what triggers you. Get rid of cult souvenirs or lock them away in a storage area if you think you may want to reference them someday. Again, keep a log, stay healthy. Research indicates that triggering happens most frequently when you are anxious, stressed, fatigued, or ill, and secondarily when you're distracted, lonely, or uncertain. This very gathering may set off lots of triggers for many of you just because we're talking about these things. I think someone yesterday was saying how she didn't expect to get triggered here, and oh my goodness, she did, because she wasn't in the move, but whoops, right? and ask other survivors what works for them, but beware, don't compare yourself to them or judge yourself by someone else's progress. That's never helpful. You are a unique human being with your own journey. Recovering from this type of traumatic experience will not end the moment you leave the abusive situation, nor will it end after the first few weeks or months away from the group. On the contrary, depending on your circumstances, aspects of that experience may require some attention for the rest of your life. In an earlier book that I co-wrote with clinical psychologist,
it switched on.
In an earlier book that I co-wrote with clinical psychologist Dr. Margaret Singer, we outlined 5 areas of post-cult adjustment. These likely will be relevant to you. The 5 categories are practical, psychological, emotional, cognitive, social, personal, and philosophical attitudinal. I have a handout available at the back table that outlines these and some of the typical issues likely to come up in each area. And of course, that chart is also in the book, Cults in Our Midst. You may sometimes feel that it's all one big murky mush that seems impossible to get a handle on. That's why I believe that deconstruction of the experience is so important. Some people have found it very helpful to recreate their time in the group on paper, not in real life. Try to chart out what happened, when and why. Now, it may seem counterintuitive to relive it, but the better you understand intellectually what happened to you, the better you can handle it emotionally. You can chart out your experiences year by year, month by month, as best you remember, and perhaps leave a column on the right where you can jot in notes or reminders that will help you get a grasp on what happened and why. I did that after I got in my cult, and it was so helpful. I was like, oh, let's see, I got put on trial then. Oh, that was right after I came back from a trip with Leader to Europe, and she wanted to shut me up because she was so drunk all the time. You know, it's like you can suddenly see, you know, or what else was going on in the group that this happened to you, or you got sent there. So seeing the enormity of it again helps you understand, A, why you succumb to it. But I mean, this is huge, this system, right? How could you not succumb to it? And it'll help you unpack some of the guilt and shame and other things that you may be feeling about these different experiences. If there was a specific ideology or belief system put forth, their philosophy of the practice, the underpinnings of why they say they do what they do, take that apart as well. See if it has any theological or historical or philosophical roots that are valid. Debunk it so that it no longer has any hold on you. As Dave was saying, even the Bible tells us, you know, challenge it, take it apart, think about it, you know. And perhaps there may have been some good elements. This way you can sort those out and not have to throw out the good with the bad. These exercises may not be easy to do. You may not want to do them all in one sitting. You may not want to do them if you're feeling particularly vulnerable or shaky. You may want to do it with someone else, a trusted friend, or someone else who is in the same or similar cult. Learn to take things on a little at a time. Not every issue or after effect is going to be resolved all at once. Perhaps make a list of the things that trouble you most, then prioritize it and work on things systematically. Or if you reach a block in one area, go back to your list and pick out some other area to work on. Don't let it overwhelm you. Not everything needs to be settled today. You're no longer under siege mentality like you were in the cult, right? You've got your whole life ahead of you. If you no longer trust or feel you don't know how to have healthy relationships, there's a section in the book on that as well. I'm not really pushing the book. Engaging in healthy and trusting relationships after such a traumatic and invasive experience as you have endured is one of life's big challenges. But it's important to take on that challenge eventually so that you can create a solid and trustworthy social network around you. Establish a support system for yourself. Choose your friends wisely. Don't associate with people who bring you down. Don't think you have to tell everyone you encounter what you went through. There's often a tendency to say too much too soon, with family or on the job or with new acquaintances. That's left over from the time in the cult when you were not allowed to have any boundaries at all and confessions were a constant. You can now establish your own personal space and guard it well. When you begin to feel invaded or encroached upon or violated, or as though you're losing your balance or perspective, trust your gut, trust your instinctive reactions. The bottom line is that you get to decide what feels safe and what you feel prepared to discuss or explain. If you're having trouble sleeping, remember the old remedies. Drink some warm milk. Eat turkey. Apparently turkey has a lot of that. Play soft music. Now this one should be easy here in Alaska. Go outside and get cold and then jump back to bed. That should activate your parasympathetic nervous system and slow your heart rate so that you will fall asleep. We have a hard time with that one in California. But and you may also want to seek out an ethical cognitive therapist. this. No tricks, no gimmicks, no new age nonsense, just good old talk therapy. I realize that many of you may be hesitant to open up to any mental health professional after what you've been through and the way you were betrayed by an authority figure. But there are good therapists out there who can help. And there's a checklist in the book for evaluating a good therapist. Now, I'm not a big pill pusher, but there are some very good medications available now for anxiety, panic attacks, and depression. You don't have to suffer as much as you may be suffering. Remember, you probably got used to suffering while you were confined in the cult. Perhaps you became desensitized to that kind of personal pain, or you think you should just suck it up and take it. That's a bankrupt philosophy. If there is a prescribed medication you can take for a time that will relieve some of your pain and allow you to function more effectively, please consider it. Talk with your doctor or therapist about it. You probably don't have to be on it forever, but it can be a wonderful short-term solution to getting through the really rough spots. I'm all for happy pills. Find what works for you and work on it. Do what you can when it feels right, and if it seems like too much, but you don't want to think about it another minute, then don't. Trust your gut, follow your instincts. You can now. It does get better. The pain and the bad memories, the nightmares, the panic attacks will recede into the background. And never forget, you are strong enough to survive the most horrific ordeal. You are surely strong enough to succeed now. Thank you.
About the free will, that it's within the confines of the, of the group and stuff. Would you have a different definition for the second generation, people in that? I mean, would it be the same?
Or? It would be the same. I mean, their free will was the will of the group.
Their free will is the will of the group.
Right. Your will, what you want to do, is what the group wants you to do. So your choices are group choices. Right? Yeah.
Janja, when you were speaking, a little mantra surfaced in my mind that I heard from another former Looney. They were describing their situation when they were getting indoctrinated, and the phrase she said was, we would say it all the time, and I said, what was it? And she said it was free will, but no choice.
No.
And that was what they were saying to themselves. That was part of their brainwashing process.
Yeah.
Free will, but no choice. Yeah.
Right. I mean, another example is the Heaven's Gate. If you saw those videos of the Heaven's Gate people just before they committed suicide, on twos, sometimes threes, saying, oh, I'm so happy to do this. I'm doing this of my own free will, la, 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 la. Okay. First of all, the night before, Doe, the leader, gives his talk, and they're all sitting in front of him, and he basically is imparting exactly what to think about this whole process. But they are sitting outside on the lawn of their mansion at the time, in front of everyone else, right? And they're all sitting there saying, oh, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this of my own free will. Public confession, public testimonials are so powerful. Once you say it in front of everyone else, where everyone else is saying, you're not going to say, oh, you know what, guys? I'm not going to do it. You're not going to do that. So is that free will? It's like the suicides in Jonestown. I don't call those suicides. There was no choice there, Yeah.
What about Dr. John Clark when he talked about the ego destruction? How do you feel about that in light of free will issues? I mean, ego destruction is a powerful thing and it affects your choices.
Right. I mean, yeah. It's all the same thing. I mean, free will, as I said, is such an amorphous concept. It's really, and where it comes in here is primarily in court cases, right? Where they want to say, oh, well, he did this, And Paul Martin and some of us have been able to testify in courts to get reduced sentences for cult victims who carried out crimes like Lee Malvo, the kid with
Muhammad.
The kid who shot through the John Muhammad was his leader, and he was the young kid in the back of the car in Washington D.C. and they were killing him. And he had the kid do it, and it was this 17-year-old kid that he was in control of, and it was basically a one-on-one cult, if I call him one-on-one cult. Paul Martin got a reduced sentence, not the death sentence, he got life, testifying that, he was under the influence of John Muhammad. This is true of the Manson girls as well. The Manson girls will never be paroled, have been in prison longer than practically anyone else in history. One of them never even killed anybody. She stabbed a dead person, but she had to get blood on her hands. They'll never be paroled. And because people think, oh, well, they did that. Not understanding that they were under Manson's influence. What else could they have done? Run and get stabbed themselves? Sure. But I think we need the courts to get a better understanding of that. Anyone else? Okay. I'll come back to this.
All right. So I'd like us all to give a hand to all the speakers that came so far to speak today. So really appreciate you taking your time and personal resources to be here. I think that we've all learned a lot and are better prepared to support other people that are in situations like this and know what to look for so we don't get into a cult in Alaska where they're so prolific. So anyways, I'm really glad that you guys could all make it, and it's been a good 2 days. So thank you for coming.
A hand of thanks to our
some from Janja and one from Janet. So if you guys want to, are interested in buying any of those, see Michelle or I or one of the authors, and we know the prices for those. I can just talk to the speakers about that. It might be easier just for just a small group of us just to get together. We'll go to Denali tomorrow. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah. Looking forward to it.
You can see pretty from here, but that was really pretty.
Yeah. Do you have any sense of, sure. The Northern Lights, is that like we have like several days left. Is it possible to see this?
I've never up that
way. Oh, okay.
This time of year, I'm not sure.
Not sure. I've heard mixed things about sometimes people say you can see them.